is doing this part of it something you ever considered when you agreed to do this all these years ago?
Not at all. I mean, it's an entirely different side of things, definitely. I mean, it's, you know, we've been, I've seen, you know, that side of making a film for so long and become so comfortable on the set, you know, but now I'm seeing this side of it, which is entirely different. You know, it's very bizarre.
So were you consciously consenting when this actually started, or did you?
Definitely, yeah. I mean, I was, you know, I was very, you know, I was enthused. I wanted to act, you know. I think especially, you know, even more so really when I was younger than ever, I saw myself as an actor, I think, you know. And you know, I liked Rick's work, and I had a pretty unconventional life growing up, so kind of the, you know, the strangeness of the project and of the idea intrigued me, I think, you know, when I was young. And even though, you know, that said, there's really, obviously there's no way to really grasp like how long 12 years is, or how something, you know, how big of a part of your life something, you know, will end up being that you spend that much time on. You know, you just don't have many life experiences to kind of reference, you know. You don't know how things affect you.
So how big a part of your life was it over the first, say, half of the film?
Well,
that you made?
I mean, it's strange, you know, because it was never very like invasive, you know. It was a small, it was a couple weeks out of the year tops, really. So it, you know, as far like schedule, you know, as far as my schedule, it never was that really that big of a part of my life, you know. Mm-hmm. But I was never in school, you know. I was homeschooled, so I never had much structure growing up, you know. I never had many commitments that I had to keep, and the film kind of was that, you know. It was the only structure and the only commitment I ever really had. So in that way, it definitely was a big part of my life, you know. That was the thing that I did growing up, you know, and I did all kinds of other things, mm-hmm. but it was something that I really had to, you know, that I kind of committed to and felt obligated to, and, you know, really threw myself into, which was definitely a big part of my life.
I was having a conversation with somebody the other day about the idea of committing to doing that, you know, how did the kid commit for so long and that kind of thing. And it's like, it is an interesting phenomenon because the adults kind of know what they're getting themselves into, and you're kind of really could have not the slightest idea in the world,
yeah.
And nor the, you know, the maturity to really stick with it. I mean, I guess easier when Rick's daughter was involved. He could,
right.
Like, kind of move her in that direction. You're kind of on your, you'd take
definitely, yeah.
Well.
And I mean, I think, you know, they can't contract you for 12 years. You know, they can't really force you to, they couldn't have forced me to do anything. So if I had lost interest or decided I hated it or, you know, whatever, for whatever reason, not wanted to, then I would have stopped, you know. But I think, you know, Rick made it a really pleasant environment and a really kind of positive learning experience for me. You know, I've always been really interested in art of all kinds, you know, and just making art is really what I want to do with my life, and to, you know, to just be around the creative process like that and kind of get to have that outlet to really throw myself into year after year was very therapeutic for me and always a really positive thing. So I never had any, it's good that it turned out that way, because, you know, I certainly, you know, I could have lost interest, right?
So there was no moment where you had that urge to rebel and say, screw it, I'm not doing this anymore?
Yeah, not really. You know, I mean, my parents were, I've never really been in trouble in my life. I've never really had any reason to rebel from anything. So I don't have that urge. You know, it's like if something's good, it's just good. You know, I feel like a lot of people are so boxed in as children that it's like, you just have to rebel against anything you do. You know, you have just that urge that it's like, you just have to define yourself. And I never had that, you know. My parents just kind of let me be my own person. And so if I was doing something, it was because I wanted to do it. And, you know, the same is true of Boyhood, I think.
There's that great James Dean line where he says, what are you rebelling against? He goes, what do you got? It's like, anything, I'll take it all.
Definitely.
So is the process of doing it change for you as time went on? Did just the actual way you were working as an actor change?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, you know, when I was young, I was just kind of along for the ride. You know, I mean, I loved it and I enjoyed it and I was very enthusiastic and engaged, I think. But you still, you know, you don't really know. You don't really know what acting even is entirely. So as I got older, it became much more of, you know, much more conscious, and I became much more, you know, collaborative, I think, and much more, you know, kind of invested in the project and in the process, and kind of, you know, put more of myself into it, at least consciously, you know. Right. As a child, you don't even know how to hold yourself back. So there's, you know, I was putting myself into it then, but it was just because I didn't know how not to, you know. But as I got older, it became, you know, more kind of calculated of, you know, which parts of my life I wanted to kind of use to build the character, and you know, what things would fit and what things would help to kind of, you know, flesh out the story.
Was there a set script from the beginning?
No, I mean Rick definitely had hit like the story arc. You know, I don't even think he had it written, but he certainly had it in his head. But as far as, you know, dialogue, that was, you know, I mean, a lot of times we would write the dialogue the day before we shot it. You know, it was always, that was, you know, Rich's never really that concerned with the specifics of things, you know, I mean, he has a very specific plan for things, but it's in this very kind of general, like, almost, you know, an enigmatic kind of way, you know, that it's just, he knows the tone and you know, the kind of the direction, you know, that it's going and how the characters feel and that kind of thing. But as far as what's actually, what the exchanges are, you know, that was more just kind of generated by just talking through it, you know, and the you know, the characters or the actors would kind of get together and, you know, we would relate our own experiences and our own, you know, the way we talk to our parents or our children or our, you know, our friends or whatever. I mean, not my children, but, you know, but their children and my parents and, you know, generate the dialogue naturally that way. So, I mean, and so that's, it was always, you know, we never even really had to learn the lines that, you know, because they were just, because we had, you know, they were just in our heads. We had just, you know, made them. We had just kind of, it was a constant kind of process of building the characters and building the scenes. So it never really felt like learning a script or anything, you know.
So were you invited in more by Rick, or did you just kind of naturally, as you matured, have more interest in participating in that conversation in a more thorough way?
It was both. I mean, it just kind of happened naturally, you know. I mean, when I was younger, I think Rick, it was more, you know, kind of Rick pulling information out of me, you know, and kind of gauging, you know, subtly trying to gauge where I was at without being, you know, too invasive or making me feel on the spot or self-conscious or something, and kind of, you know, trying to, you know, get a feel for, you know, just where I was at socially and emotionally and that kind of thing. But then as I got older, you know, it just kind of naturally turned into, you know, more of a conversation and more of, you know, me relating my experiences to him and then, you know, me, you know, a lot of times he would kind of give me assignments, you know, kind of homework about, like, you know, so this is going to happen in the film this year, you know, you're going to talk to this girl in the woods and, you know, have this kind of romantic conversation, you know, and so, like, take notes when you do that, you know, when you talk to a girl, like, remember how it goes and what the energy is like and what you talk about and how you feel about it and that kind of thing. So it just, you know, it happened very naturally to the point where, you know, by the end I was as much of a part of it as anyone else.
And did you spend much time in conversations or just in contact off your couple weeks of production every year? Or was there kind of an ongoing relationship that was...
Yeah, I mean, you know, here and there. We definitely, I think we would... I'd have lunch with Rick at least once, you know, once or twice throughout the year, usually. It certainly wasn't constant or anything, but... But, you know, he would generally come to me at least a few months before shooting and kind of, you know, let me know where the story was at and kind of what his thoughts were and, you know, what kind of things I could expect and, you know, maybe give me an assignment of something to look out for in my life, and, you know, kind of that kind of thing.
Girls are coming.
Yeah, sorry.
And what about actually working with actors? I mean, your Lorelai was kind of your sidekick, but not a professional actor. You have two very, very experienced actors and a few others.
Yeah.
Did how you work together change outside of just maturing into being an adult yourself?
I mean, you know, I'm sure it did, but I'm not sure I can put my finger on it, because it was just so gradual and such a kind of... By the time I was conscious of it, it had just been such a kind of common part of my life for so long that it's hard to really monitor it. But certainly, I mean, we became, you know, when I was young, it was, you know, it was about them kind of setting this place, you know, making this place for me and Lorelai to be comfortable, you know, and to kind of be able to act and kind of figure out, you know, how to act and who these characters were as we're also figuring out, you know, who we were. And as we got, you know, as we got older, it became more, you know, just more kind of, I guess I became more part of the team and just more on a similar level, I guess. Mm-hmm. Just as I became more kind of invested and more of an actor, you know, because it's, when I was young, it was just, you're just kind of there. You're just kind of doing it. But I definitely started, you know, trying more as I got older.
So once things went in the can, did you look at anything? Had you seen dailies even or
no,
anything?
No, I had never. Rick didn't let Lorelai or I see any of it until the finished product.
Did you think 6 years in, oh yeah, I did that thing when I was 5 years ago? Were you even able to conceive it at that point?
I mean, very little. You know, I mean, I have these abstract kind of memories that are half stories that I've heard and half things that I actually remember, and now, you know, images from the film that I've seen. So I don't know. Yeah, I mean, not really. It was always very kind of abstract for me, you know, to have this kind of timeline of my life, you know, that I guess most people have school, you know, they have school that kind of marks their life as they progress. You can remember, oh, I did that in first grade and second grade, but I didn't have that. I had this, you know, it was kind of the only real consistent thing. But it was also, you know, school is every day. This was 2 weeks.
Well, memory, I think, changes also as you get older. You kind of lock into things in a much more specific way.
You just become more engaged in your reality, I think, you know, and kind of more things stand out to you when you're a kid. You just, it's all just there. You don't even know what anything is, you know, so.
We did one of these with Ethan. We did like an hour and a half, maybe.
Wow.
About his whole career and everything and different work he's done. And it's like, he remembers everything. Like, he has very specific memories, not from being a kid, but from being like, you know, when he did theater 10 years ago or 15 years ago, whatever, you know, exact things that happened to the set and everything else. And I guess
it's incredible. I hope I can develop memory like that. You know, I mean, I've spent most of my life just kind of floating through my experiences, you know, and it kind of breaks my heart, you know, because there's a lot of my life that I wish I could, you know, recall with more meaning, but, you know,
You have one of the best Hope movies ever made, though.
Yeah,
you couldn't really ask for better.
Yeah, no, I mean, absolutely, it's incredible. It's incredible to, you know, the response we're getting from people.
So, what was the experience like when you first saw the picture? Did you see it before Sundance?
Or? Yeah. Rick very wisely suggested that I watch it alone the first two times. Mm-hmm. And it was, I mean, it's brutal. It's very emotional for me. You know, very tender, just a very, very intimate, you know, the project was a very, you know, intimate and tender part of my life, and just, you know, it's a part of myself and a part of life that's really hard to see, you know, the way you change over time. That's something that few people really get to experience, like the way just yourself aging and the way, you know, the way you've changed and the way you haven't changed, you know, how similar I really am to the way I was, you know, when I started the project. Like, I'm more or less the same person that I was 12 years ago, but I don't know. I think kind of lost where I was going. But it's beautiful. I mean, it really is, and it.
So it's happy emotion more than. It was melancholy.
It's just everything. I mean, it's painful. It's definitely painful, but not really in a negative way. It's just kind of. It's just tender, you know. It's just a tender thing to see, you know, because there, you know, a lot of some, because Rick, you know, was able to keep things so comfortable, especially for me and, you know, Lorelai. I think that there's so much of us on, you know, projected that I wasn't even aware of, you know, that these kind of subconscious emotions that. Especially in the kind of when you're a teenager, you're so emotional and you're projecting so much that you aren't aware of, you know. So there are parts of myself that are reflected on screen that I didn't even, you know, I didn't know anybody could see that, and to just see it, you know, and see it kind of sympathetically, and just see it in the grand scheme of this long catalog of my you know, my childhood. It is painful, you know, and it's tender to see it in front of me like that, but it's also very comforting and therapeutic to kind of, you know, it forces me to not be so hard on myself.
Is there anything in it that you thought that Rick or the cut was not sympathetic to, or might have been more sympathetic to in your life?
No, I don't know, not really. I mean, it's all just kind of there, I guess. It's also a very crafted character, and that's kind of the strange thing, is that as much as it's this kind of direct emotional reflection of myself, it's also this kind of artistic reflection of myself, and, you know, in this character that I helped to kind of create, so it's, I don't know, it's a doozy.
I guess the age changes are more of jump cuts for you than for the audience.
Yeah.
I mean, it's one of the magical things about the movie, is as you're watching it, you're kind of always monitoring when things are changing.
Yeah.
So doesn't Mark point it out.
yeah, definitely.
But for you, it must have been a little more clear.
Yeah, I always kind of, you know, I kind of know. It's, you definitely have more of a kind of finger on yourself, I guess. But.
And do you have that kind of, I mean, we hear from a lot of actors and directors that they, you know, their memories of watching a film, when they watch a film, they're remembering the day or the, you know, things that happened on set that day and all that. Or is that
right.
Part of it for you, or much less so?
In the later years, more definitely. I mean, the last few years I have, you know, I have a lot of memories of and what, you know, what I felt like and what, you know, what those days were like and, you know, just how kind of, how meaningful, especially the last, you know, I mean, the last shoot was very, very beautiful and very meaningful to all of us, I think. But earlier on, it's so, I mean, that's kind of one of the strangest things, is just seeing, you know, this little person that I intellectually know as me, but I don't remember being that person, and then, you know, seeing myself doing stuff I don't remember doing. It's bizarre.
Is there anything missing that you thought would be there, or anything there that you were surprised was there?
Not really, you know. I mean, it's pretty much all in there. There was one scene that with me and some of the kind of teenage friends, like ad-libbing a bunch of jokes, that I think the lighting was kind of messed up, so that wasn't in there. But other than that, I mean, Rick is very efficient, you know. We didn't really film anything that we didn't need to, so.
So your two private showings. Where you watched it.
Yeah.
And then did you watch it the third time at Sundance?
Yeah. Yeah, I've and I watched it at Berlinale as well. I've seen it quite a few times now.
So did the experience change that when you saw it with an audience? And
definitely. There was a lot of energy in that room, you know, and it was very supportive to, you know, it became less of a personal experience and more of just kind of general, and, you know, and less about Mason or me, which I think is beautiful. That's really, you know, it is what it is to me, but as far as what the film actually means, you know, it's really not about Mason, even though it's his perspective. It's Boyhood. That's the perspective, you know, it's his eyes that you're looking at the world through, but I think so much more than that, it's just about life and kind of the passage of time and the importance of just everyday kind of existence, you know, and that's really what, you know, stands out to me more, watching it with an audience and talking to people afterwards, you know, is just is just how universal so much of what we experience is. You know, you get so wrapped up in the specifics of your life and your situations, but it's we all, you know, basically go through the same kind of, the same passage of time.
So it may have seemed more distant, but in some ways this Sundance and since then have been the opportunities for people to kind of the wave of love to come in your direction.
Yeah, absolutely.
Is that an experience you could anticipate, or have you, how's your experience with that been?
Absolutely not. I mean, I had no idea, you know. I mean, I don't think any of us expected this, you know. We really, at least I, you know, I managed, I didn't have any expectations, you know. I've never had a film released before. I didn't think about the fact that people, that there was going to be a reception, you know, that people were going to have opinions about it. And but it's incredible. I mean, the warmth that I get from people and the familiarity, you know. I mean, it's, you know, I have trouble with getting a lot of attention, you know. It's weird. It's hard for me to, you know, to be in this position of talking to so many people. But it's just when I, you know, when I look at so many actors and kind of, you know, people that are in the public eye are approached with such an impersonal kind of attitude, and you know, I don't get that. I get a very, very personal, you know, interactions with people, and I'm really grateful.
So are you enjoying it, as it were?
I am. I mean, yeah, it's a ride, you know.
You probably spent more consistent amount of time in releasing the movie
than I ever did making it. Yeah. Well, we never talked about it like this, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's the thing. We were very lost in the artistic process, you know, and just the what we were doing. We were very lost in it, and so to be analyzing it like this is a very new ground, you know, for all of us, I think. At least for me. I don't know.
We've had the conversation about what the difference, you know, everybody now has a camera, everybody has their camera phone and everything else, and like, what's the difference between a professional and an amateur now? Right. And I always say it's intent. I mean, that's the only real thing that separates, is that, you know, somebody has the idea that they're going to turn this into something that is a piece of art, as opposed to just shooting videos of their friends or selfies or whatever.
Yeah.
And I think Rick is the one who is the only one who had that in his head, it sounds like. It sounds like the whole idea was to create a place where you could play.
Yeah.
A couple weeks a year.
Yeah, and he set that tone of intent, you know, and that's an incredible thing that I've learned, you know, is just to be intentional without being like reward oriented, you know. I think he has an amazing way of doing that, you know, of being very focused and knowing what he aims to do without being worried about the end product, you know. I mean, and that's really the way art should be, I think, you know. It's all about the process, but it's also, you know, you're working towards something, and I don't know.
So where does it leave you at this point? Or do you know?
Yeah.
Are you just trying to survive this year?
Yeah, I mean, right now it's like I'm just trying to get through, you know, all of this promotion, really. But I don't know. I mean, what I've learned really is that, you know, creating art is the only place that I find solace, you know, that I feel at peace. So wherever that takes me, you know, whether that's acting or otherwise, it, you know, that's
does
what
this preclude
I, that's what
you
I
being
do.
Harry Potter or whatever in the next, you know.
I mean that's kind of the thing, you know. Everyone's asking me if I want to be an actor, and it's like, I don't know. I don't really want to just be an actor. I want to, you know, I want to work on projects that are sincere and, you know, meaningful to me, and acting can definitely be an outlet to that. But I don't want to just act as a job, you know. Right. I don't want to just do it because, you know, to make money.
And being famous is not a big draw for you, I guess.
Not really. Yeah.
I mean, and where are your parents through all of this? I mean, are they at peace with it, or is it just like, okay, man, let's see what happens? Or
yeah, I mean, they were big fans of Rick's, you know, so they were always very excited for me and very, you know, supportive. You know, they have a great a great way of, you know, supporting me, but not ever being pushy or having really an agenda for me in any way or the other. So yeah, they were kind of just along for the ride, really, you know, just happy to get to come to set when they did. And you know, my mom came to Berlin and my dad went to Sundance, so you know, I think they're pretty blown away by the movie, definitely. But
it must be surreal for them.
I can only imagine. Yeah.
Have they talked to you about it? I mean, is it?
There are few words, really. You know, I mean, they've definitely. I mean, you know, it's very touching to them, but it's the things that it, you know, the things that it kind of speaks to in you and in the audience and in us, you know, having made it, are just kind of nonverbal. You know, it's hard to really put your finger on exactly what it is that really strikes you. But
and are there things that they particularly want for you at this point, or it sounds like they're the kind of people who go with the flow, who want you to kind of experience life and just be?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, they want me to be happy, really, you know, and so whatever that means, they'll support me, I think. I don't think they want me to be famous or anything, or be, you know, be some kind of Hollywood guy, so. But I'm sure they would support me if I chose that, you know, if I moved here and decided to, like, throw myself into acting completely. You know, they would be happy for me, but...
And generally, because that's the only way it really can be, since you don't know the answer, really, I mean, what do you think, what wins do you think will come to push you in a direction one way or the other? I mean, if people start knocking on the door 24/7 trying to drag you out here... Are you susceptible to that, or do you want to find a quiet place where you can go do artistic work, or
both? I mean, yeah. I mean, I definitely need a quiet place. I, you know, I value my solitude very much, but I also really crave, you know, work and working on things. So it's really just, you know, it'll be a matter of kind of finding the right, you know, the right project and the right people to work with. Mm. Which I'm sure will happen before too long, really. You know, there are a lot of great people out there, so.
And you went through homeschooling through high school, I guess, technically?
I did go to a couple years of high school, okay. And then got my GED, so.
And are you interested in the collegiate universe? Or
yeah, I actually, I want to go to art school. It's kind of the point I'm at now. That's really kind of my next step, you know, is I just want to, you know, I learned a lot about life growing up, but you know, I didn't learn a lot of academic studies, so I kind of crave knowledge at this point, you know. So I think so.
It seems like you're invested in a fair amount of wisdom.
Well,
for a young man.
You know.
That's all you get, I guess.
Yeah, but I don't know geography or history or anything like that, so you know, I'd like to know a little bit more about the world I live in.
We'll just get you an iPhone and you're all set.
Indeed.